Hello, everyone. This week we are going to learn about learning styles and yourself. So, what some people don't realize is that they have preferred ways of sort of receiving and disseminating information, and that can be really, really important when you venture out into your college career because you'll run into a variety of different professors with a lot of different ways of disseminating their information, and you have to know what works best for you so that you can work around it and make sure that you are getting all of the education you can possibly muster. So what is a learning style? A learning style is just your preferred method of acquiring, using, and thinking about knowledge. Now this says preferred. You might have a bunch of different learning styles that work for you, but there may be one or a couple that you actually receive information better with than perhaps some of the others. So let's go over them. These are the different types of learning styles, and I'll sort of give you what they are, and then we'll get into how it is to make those learning styles work for you. So there is the reading and writing learning style. If you like this kind of style, then you get the majority of your information by either just being able to read a textbook or by taking down notes in class. If you are a visual learner, you are a person that is really, really into when there are charts and graphs and diagrams and pictures that can help you remember the information better. You are more likely to enjoy perhaps getting your information from a textbook that has a lot of pictures than perhaps reading a book in a literature class that doesn't have any fancy pictures in them. Then there is the auditory verbal learning style, which is kind of what we're working with here now, where I am lecturing to you and you can actually gather the information better because I am telling it to you rather than having you just read the lecture. And there is also tactile kinesthetic. So that one maybe a little bit more difficult to sort of work out in most of your classes, but there are ways of getting around it. It's basically you like to, if there is a piece of furniture in your house that you're trying to put together, you would much rather learn how to do it by just trying to do it rather than reading the instructions. You like taking things apart and putting them back together, and that is how you learn whatever it is you want to learn. You learn by doing rather than reading or having somebody else teach you. So if you have a reading and writing style, then you prefer your information presented visually in a written form. So if this sounds like you, you don't mind reading, you don't mind taking written notes, whether those are with your pen and paper or if that's on your laptop or an iPad or something, then wherever possible, write out your summaries and your study sheets, and you can be the kind of person that will take your notes, and then at a later date, right before an exam, you sort of compile all of those notes and sort of rewrite them again and form some sort of study sheet. If you see sort of pictures and diagrams and those don't work as well for you, then maybe write them down and describe what it is that they're trying to teach you. Turn diagrams and math problems into words, stuff like that. So try to turn things into words as much as possible. If you are a visual learner, then you really like yourself some diagrams and pictures, which unfortunately I wish I had more of in my lectures, so sorry to my visual learners. But if you do have this style, try to create a diagram and a chart or a table or a graph, or maybe have some sort of picture that goes along with your notes so that you can try and remember the information better. So maybe, for example, learning the having the learning styles here, you might be able to associate each one of these learning styles with a particular picture. So for the read-write learning style, it might be a pencil and a paper. For this style, it can be a painting. For the next style, it can be a tape recorder or a picture of an ear, and for the tactile kinesthetic style, it might be somebody working with their hands. So if you do have an auditory verbal style, You definitely enjoy listening rather than reading explanations, and you very much like the whole in-person lecture thing. Maybe you prefer in-person lectures rather than an online class, which is, why I sort of try to cater to you as much as I possibly can in this online class. So, if you do have this style, when you're reading, if you do have to read something, say it out loud so that you can hear yourself say it. And then by hearing yourself say it, you're more likely to internalize that information. If you also have this style, it might be useful for you to find a couple of people and work in a study group so that you can talk through all of the lessons that you've learned. And always ask permission for this because some instructors are actually kind of finicky about this whole thing, but you can tape record the lectures. If you are an in-person lecture, you can have a tape recorder, just tape recorder, some sort of digital recorder. Back when, we had tape, we used a tape recorder. And you can tape record the lectures and then listen back to them at a later date. But always make sure you ask the instructor's permission first so that you don't get in trouble. And then if you have a tactile kinesthetic style, then as mentioned, you learn by doing, touching, manipulating, and tinkering. If you have this style, maybe keep yourself active as part of your note-taking session. And maybe instead of having just a plain old pen and paper, perhaps you can make an exercise where you write everything down on note cards or flashcards, and maybe you jumble them up and then you try to put them back into some sort of order. Make some sort of puzzle out of the whole note-taking experience, and maybe by drawing the actual diagrams, that might actually get you to better internalize what those diagrams mean. Now, if you have a whole bunch of multiple intelligences, which we pretty much all do, then you can be good or sort of naturally, quote unquote, good at certain things. So these are all of the different intelligences that you can be good at. So the first one is logical mathematical. That's sort of you're really, really good at problem solving. If you have more of a linguistic intelligence, you're really good at things involving language and vocabulary, reading, writing. If you have a decent amount of spatial intelligence, then you're pretty good at art, architecture. You'd probably be pretty good at making your way through a video game, maybe navigating all sorts of different kinds of spaces. If you have an interpersonal intelligence, then you're really, really good at relating with others. People might call you a people person. You're really, really good with people. You might be suited to, say, like a customer service job or something. If you are a person that has intrapersonal intelligence, then you have really good access to your own feelings. Maybe you have some pretty good intuition. You're able to recognize when you're getting angry, when you're getting frustrated, when maybe you're about to shut down, and with that access to your feelings and being able to recognize what it is that you're feeling at a certain time, you are able to compensate for it and express it appropriately. Some people don't necessarily have that intelligence. But to have really good intrapersonal experience can actually be really, really good when you are striking out on your own and you sort of need to fend for yourself in a collegiate environment. If you have good musical intelligence and you have a good ear for music, you have bodily kinesthetic intelligence, you can use your body pretty well. You might be a good dancer. You might be really, really good at sort of motion-controlled games. Maybe you're good at using the Wii or using games that involve the Kinect. Maybe you are a sports-type person, and that could be where your intelligence lies. And also a naturalist. You could be a naturalist. You could be really, really good at seeing patterns in nature. Perhaps you are really, really interested in things like the weather, sensing perhaps what animals feel, and maybe you would probably be well suited for a science or maybe even something like a veterinarian position. So we have ways of receiving information, and we have a lot of intelligences that perhaps we can be seen as good at. Then we sort of turn to our personality styles, and being able to recognize our personality styles is really, really useful. We can then sort of navigate our way through the collegiate world if we kind of understand the kind of person we are. So if you are an introvert, that basically means that you can be very, very independent. Sometimes you're the kind of person that has a tendency to get maybe even a little exhausted if you have to deal with a lot of people in any given day, and sometimes you just kind of like to retreat and be alone for a while, and you're very, very comfortable with being alone. If you are an extrovert, then you work well with others. You love being in groups, maybe you are the life of the party. You don't mind group work. You don't mind engaging in class discussion. You generally work pretty well with others. Then there is the sort of having intuition versus sensing. If you are an intuition type person, you are all about being sort of creative and looking at the big picture and how it is that the sort of actions that you do can affect a wide variety of things. Whereas if you are a sensor, then you are more of a sort of logical person, you are a detail-oriented person, you are more concerned about all of the different steps of this current math problem or this current assignment. You like to look at whatever it is that you have to do this week in detail. Rather than, say, somebody who is an intuiter, which can look at, maybe the whole semester in advance and sort of seeing all of the different things that have to go into making a semester successful. If you are a thinker, then you apply logic. If you are a feeler, you are more likely to engage with your emotions and let those guide you. And if you are a perceiver, then before making a judgment, you really need to sort of have some evidence. You're not likely to believe the very, very first thing a person tells you. You don't want to make a judgment on another person or on any sort of project, before learning more. Whereas if you are a judger, you are quick to judge. You're very, very quick to go with your gut. You are likely to perhaps trust people and trust people's opinions and just go off of them immediately rather than gaining more evidence. There are all sorts of online quizzes that you can take in order to gauge your actual personality style. One of them for this particular thing is the Myers-Briggs personality sort of style quiz. And I will write that out. Myers-Briggs. Ooh. Myers-Briggs personality tests abound on the internet. And so if you want to sort of know exactly what your personality style is, definitely check out one of these quizzes. And you can certainly, now, of course, a lot of these quizzes aren't necessarily the most scientific things in the world, so take them with a grain of salt. But even through answering the questions of the quiz, no matter what the result actually ends up being, it can tell you a lot about what your personality style is. These things are important for going through your college experience and sort of seeing what kinds of things you can be cut out for in terms of extracurricular activities. Perhaps maybe if you are in the process of maybe even something like trying to find a roommate to live with you. Knowing your personality style and knowing the other person's personality style can be very, very useful in working with other people. So, where do these learning style origins come from? Right? Just kind of redundant. Where do these learning styles come from? There is sort of a difference between kind of left brain processing and right brain processing. You have probably heard somebody say something to the effect of, oh, you know, I'm a very left brain kind of person, or I'm a very right brain kind of person. And that usually refers to where their learning styles and where their preferences are. If you are a quote-unquote left brain person, then you are more of a verbal sort of learner. The thinking, the reading, the speaking, use of vocabulary is kind of your bag. If you are more of a right brain person, then you are more into these sort of non-verbal styles of learning. So that is where perhaps the tactile kinesthetic people would fall, any sort of music-related people, those that perhaps have a visual learning style as well. Now remember, all of this stuff applies to your instructors as well. So keep that in mind. Not only do you all have all sorts of different styles of learning, instructors have all sorts of different ways of learning themselves and also disseminating that information. So depending on what kind of a professor you have, you might find it useful to kind of use your learning style and kind of interpret and work with the information the professor is giving you in whatever way they're giving it to you so that you can better have use of it. So for your journal, I'm going to ask you to sort of learn about your receptive learning style. There's actually a link to a quiz that you can take in order for you to actually learn what your learning style is. And then based on that, I want you to sort of answer the following questions. So think about something that you learned just because you liked learning it. You didn't have to do it for a class, it wasn't for any sort of assignment or anything. Something that you wanted to learn how to do just because you wanted to learn how to do it. So how did you collect the skills and information needed? How did you actually learn the information? Did you draw pictures? Did you actually work with it? Did you take notes about it? How did you test whether or not you actually learned the thing that you meant to learn? And how did you evaluate yourself? So when you get through clicking on the receptive learning style exercise that is under the under this week's module in Brain Honey, go ahead and fill out the journal. Make sure that you dig deep and give me lots of info. So one of the things that you're going to end up doing is you're going to learn a variety of skills in college. And mostly when some people focus on college, they tend to focus on the sort of hard skills, like you're going to go to college and you are going to learn the skills that you need in order to perform a particular job. So if you are going to be a finance major, then you learn how it is to deal with numbers and deal with money. If you want to be a chemist, you learn things like the periodic table and what chemicals are good and what chemicals are bad and all sorts of fun stuff like that, right? Those are the hard skills that you need to learn, and oftentimes those are the skills that are emphasized when people are asked why it is that they want to go to college, and why it is that they major in the thing they want to major in. However, one of the things that college does also teach you, and one of the purposes of this course, period, is to basically give you some of the quote-unquote soft skills that perhaps you don't necessarily learn in any class, unless it's maybe a business class or something that might actually teach you some of these skills, but these skills are going to be very, very useful for you going forward. So the soft skills that we're going to learn through the course of this course are taking responsibility, time management, prioritizing tasks, and self-worth. If you only focus on the hard skills, you're pretty much going to be cheating yourself out of a complete college experience. So hopefully the purpose of this class will be to not only teach you some hard skills in order to pass this class in general, but will also teach you some of the soft skills that will carry you through your college career and hopefully beyond. So who are you? One of the things that we develop over time is a self-concept, which is a view of yourself that forms over time. And these include a physical element, which is, you know, literally how you see yourself, perhaps things like body image. You have your social self, how it is that you interact with people, and your personal self-concept, and what kind of person do you really feel like you are. All of these things develop over time, and all of these things change. So throughout the course of your college career, especially if you're sort of going it on your own, you will develop a sense of self, your self-concept throughout your career. So one sort of factor of self-concept is your self-esteem, which is your overall self-evaluation. Your self-efficacy is the expectation that you are able to achieve certain goals. So whether you feel like you can do this, you can take on every task that is handed to you, or if you feel like you aren't sort of up for the task. That is what self-efficacy tells you. And there is also this concept of the self-fulfilling prophecy, which is often very much kind of potentially damaging to people throughout their college career. One example of the self-fulfilling prophecy, really, really easy, is this. And I'm sure that there are a good amount of you out there that have engaged in this self-fulfilling prophecy. So the self-fulfilling prophecy is this. Here's your example. You have a quiz coming up. Not really, but you do have a final exam. And perhaps this entire time you're thinking, I am not going to do very well on this final exam. I am not going to do well. I am going to bomb it. There is no possible way that I can pass. There's just no way. And that is your prophecy. When it becomes self-fulfilling is when you say, well, because I'm not going to pass, why bother putting in the effort? So you don't put in the effort, so you don't study, so what do you know? You end up failing the final exam and thus perhaps the entire class. That is a self-fulfilling prophecy. Because you say that you're not going to be able to do something, you don't take the steps that would make you do something, and therefore you can't do anything. So, in order to turn that self-fulfilling prophecy around, you have to engage in some form of positive thinking. Have good self-esteem, have a good sense of self-efficacy, and that way, you'll be able to instead turn I won't be able to pass that test into, wow, this test is hard, but I can do it. I can do it, and especially I can do it if I just put in the work. And turning that around and having those positive sort of affirmations even are really good key into motivating you to get stuff done so that your self-fulfilling prophecy will be a good thing. I'm going to nail this. I am going to put in the work so that I can nail this, and therefore, what do you know? I did well. So one cool thing in order to sort of help motivate you is the creation of a mission statement. Now, usually, mission statements might be something that are reserved only for the business world, but a personal mission statement can actually be very, very helpful and be a good source of motivation. So what is a mission statement? A mission statement is a formal statement regarding what you hope to achieve during your lifetime. And let's create our mission statement. I'm not going to sort of make you do one for your journal purposes, but let's try it out. So how do we create our own personal mission statement? You identify your values. Choose five things that you feel are really, really important to you, and try to figure out why it is that they are important. So examples of values can be things like love, security, happiness, wealth, friendship, wisdom, etc. So choose five things that you pretty much find very, very important, like perhaps, you know, something like family, and try and figure out why those things are important to you. Now, when you sort of achieve what it is that you're going to achieve, then you sort of reach this idea of self-actualization. And that's kind of what we're going for. We're going for a state of self-fulfillment in which you are able to realize your highest potential in your own possible way. So when you have this mission statement and you have a sort of kind of set of goals to go for, you are able to reach this state of self-actualization. So in order to kind of achieve this self-actualization, you have to organize your motivational needs. Our very, very basic needs, our very, very basic motivation that gets us kind of up in the morning, are things like eating, you gotta feed yourself, you gotta hydrate yourself. At some point, you should probably sleep, rest, conserve energy. And those are your kind of basic needs. Beyond that, another basic need could be being social and interacting with people. In order to just be a member of society, you pretty much have to be as social as possible and have some form of interaction with the outside world. But beyond that, your other needs could be fulfilled by looking at those values. And these ideas of wealth, of family, of friendship, all of those things can be some sort of motivation. So once you sort of get the kind of like eating, sleeping, surviving stuff out of the way, having a roof over your head, then you can focus on the things that will get you to this point of self-actualization. Now, once you've summarized your important values and try to figure out what are the things that are most important and what things those things might have in common, figure out what is your major product? What is the thing that you want to produce? What is the thing that, you know, you sort of want to be? You want to create the musical album that is going to be rated one of the top 10 of all time. Maybe you want to be the person that invents something so that it makes lives a lot easier, whether it's inventing the next major mode of transportation, or maybe you're going to invent the thing that helps provide drinking water for the entire world. Maybe you want to invent something that will eliminate hunger. Or maybe you just want to become the best father, mother, friend, partner you can be, right? So maybe your major product is love and delivering love in the best way possible. And who do you want to be? Do you want to be someone who is a strong leader? Do you want to be someone who is known for being incredibly empathetic? They're able to take other people's feelings and be able to step into them. Maybe you want to be caring. Maybe you want to be kind. Maybe you want to be rich. Who knows, right? I mean, don't we all? So basically try and figure out those things. What is your major product? What is the thing that you kind of want to deliver to the world? And what is the kind of person that you want to be? So then look at your mission statement and see if whether it is sort of general enough. We're not trying to get super specific here with the mission statement, because it's supposed to guide you throughout your entire life, not necessarily just your college career. Is it long-term? Are these values, you know, the thing you want to be, the person you want to be, are these things capable of being part of a long-term plan? And is it a valid, realistic representation? If you are a finance major, perhaps it may not be the wisest mission statement to try and get yourself on the moon by the age of 30. You have to sort of be able to know yourself and see if this is a sort of valid and realistic representation of yourself and the person that you want to be. And also remember that mission statements are living documents. Just because you sort of make a plan to create the next big album doesn't necessarily mean that you're sort of stuck with that for the rest of your life. Review it periodically and see if, just because of any major experiences you might have in your life, See if your mission statement might have changed. And remember, to thine own self be true. That's a Shakespeare quote, but it's also a really, really good sort of life quote in general. To thine own self be true. And don't try to change sort of major factors about yourself. Know yourself and work within the kind of person that you are in order to make yourself and the world a better place.